एवरीवन, वेलकम टू एसएसटी कॉलेज ऑफ आर्ट्स एंड कॉमर्स. दिस इज एसएसटी एडुपीडिया. आई एम अमृता हरजानी, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर. टुडे वी वुड लाइक टू शेयर अबाउट द लेक्चर दैट इज ऑन प्रिंसिपल्स ऑफ मैनेजमेंट सब्जेक्ट. विल बी डिस्कसिंग अबाउट डिफरेंट मैनेजमेंट इम्पॉर्टेंट कॉन्सेप्ट्स एज वेल एज अबाउट द चैप्टर ऑफ डिसीजन मेकिंग. डेलीगेशन ऑफ अथॉरिटी, one of the very important concept of principles of management. What exactly this concept means? It consists of various three basic elements, that is accountability, authority and responsibility. When we are transferring the power to the lower level of subordinates or employees in the organization, so that results into an effective decision making in the organization, that is what it terms as delegation of authority. Delegation of authority results into giving an exposure to various employees towards new challenges in the organization, which will give them certain level of training as well as development towards the new activities in the organization. Apart from this, we involve various employees in the decision-making level or process in the organization, which will make them ready for the various challenges, as well as they will be, you know, very proactive towards various new situations in the organization. What are the various advantages of the delegation of authority? Delegation of authority is not only making the lower level of employees feel as an part of the organization, but it will increase their commitment level also to various challenges, to various activities, because here we are making them feel as good towards the management activities plus towards the various levels of the organization's involvement, not only to the meetings, to the various different tasks, challenges in the organization. Guidelines for effective delegations. How we are going to delegate? First of all, it is very necessary we should decide which task is to be assigned to various employees as well as to whom we should give the assignment. Even there should be, you know, sufficient resources available. Resources here are of various types, like man, material, machine, method as well as money, which should be there with each and every management to the various employees, so that they are very much prone and ready for the different challenges. There should be even an effective feedback system, because this feedback system, in case if there are loopholes in the delegation of authority, next time improvement in the different activities will be possible. Decentralization of activities and authority. Decentralization is being considered as nothing but giving lower levels in the hierarchy various activities, so that they feel as an part of the organization, as well as an idea of participation is being linked towards it, so that there will be an easy, quick response to the different activities. It will lead to a higher satisfaction in the organization. Whereas centralization of authority, it results into just limiting its decision-making power to the top-level management only. Because here, autocratic leadership style is being preferred, wherein whatever the boss is saying, that is right or wrong. But whereas in decentralization, we are involving the lower level also in the decision making activities. Formalization, decentralization and centralization. Whenever there is any kind of proof of written documentation in the organization, so that the employees are directed towards certain rules and regulations, that is formalization. Centralization, in one word, if I say, authority is with top level. Decision making, the authority is given to the lower level. Advantages of decentralization, what are the benefits that are being there? As the training is being given to the lower level, more they feel as in participation in various activities, different level of freedom, independence is being given to them in the decision making activities, and the burden to the top level management is being reduced to certain extent because the task is being divided into the different level of employees. There is in chances of the facilitation of different product diversification also, and it promotes the development of various general managers also in the organization, and they will be ready for the changing activities of the fast changing environment. Not only this, it will result into promoting different decision making activities because this will result into broadening the concept of the control management, plus there will be an increase in the motivation level of the employees. Disadvantages of decentralization: it is very difficult to have one uniform policy, and there will be lot of complexions in terms of not only there are coordination, but there will be also inadequate planning and control systems. There will be an unconsiderable expenses which are there because lot of training is required from the manager level side, and it will be limited to certain external forces like national labor unions will be there. There will be government controls and tax policies. What are formal and informal organizations? Whenever I am saying the term formal organization, means they are backed up by certain rules and regulations in the organization. Lot of discipline is required. Whereas informal organization, they are formed within the formal organizations only. They are interpersonal relationships kind of organizations where it is being seen. Formal organizations characteristics are being defined like this. It is being generally managed by the top management only, because various principles like division of labor and efficiency in operations are being based upon them. Now they are even concentrating on different performances of the job level only, because their roles are very much specific and they are defined. Coordination among members is required on a large scale because they are required to go through various processes and procedures. Informal organizations, on the other hand, as I said earlier, they are being dependable upon various interpersonal relationships. These groups are generally being created on the basis of some similarities if they are finding like likes, dislikes among the group members, religion, caste, on the basis of gender, on the basis of age, whereas here each and every member can join the group several times, can exit the group several times, because here group norms are not that much mandatory. This is a tabular form comparison of formal and informal groups, which is organizations, which is being shown over here. Informal groups are more flexible in nature as compared to the formal groups because they are tend to change according to the needs and wants of the group members. The informal groups are not that much structured hierarchical, because in formal groups they are more well structured hierarchy wise. Positions are very well defined because these are being formed as per the norms of organizations. Formal groups, when I am saying, they are following various procedures and rules in the organizations. The delegation of authority from the top to the bottom is being seen clearly, whereas in the informal groups, it is within the groups itself. Now we will be talking about decision making. Decision making is nothing but a very important concept in principles of management. What exactly this term means? It is very important in management to land up to certain conclusions in the organizations. Those conclusions are related with the various activities. Now, different alternatives and options that are already available with us in the organization. Those alternatives, those choices that are there with us, we need to come to some final best alternative, to some best fit that is there for the organization. The term decision making results into various aspects like programmed or non-programmed decision making nature. Program decision makings are those decisions in which we are resulting into solutions to routine problems. Oh, and non-programmed are which are very unstructured in nature, and to deal with such processes that are not at all related to the routine problems. Now, decision making involves certain risk factors or uncertainties and certainties in the organizations. We have certain elements which are measurable and accurate, and we have certain reliable information with us. Decision making, certain things are risk factors because environment is very uncertain in nature. There are certain activities in the organization which are completely being dependable upon the external environmental factors and that are being associated with it. Those external environmental factors like political, social, legal, technological are being very unpredictable in nature. So decision making is being associated with all these three elements. We will be defining now the rational model of the decision making. The first step, that is investigating the situation. For investigating the situation, it is very important that we should identify that what is the root cause problem of any activity. We should define first of all that problem based upon identification of that problem, that yes, on which we need to take the decision, we'll be proceeding further towards developing the alternative, that is the next step. In that step, we will be having various alternatives with us. Let us take an example. We are having alternatives A, B, C with us. Now, these alternatives are of various types. Looking into exploring or, you know, identifying or seeking the various creative alternatives, we will be not just coming to the conclusions. We are just here exploring the different alternatives. Next step is all about evaluating those alternatives based upon the statistical or mathematical models or methods. We will be evaluating the different mathematical models and coming to the best alternative which is fitting for the organizational profit margin. This alternative will be based upon the PESTEL analysis, that is political, economical, social factors that are technological and legal factors that are affecting the organization. We'll be doing the SWOT analysis also, that is strength, weakness, opportunities and threats. Looking after all these analyses, we will be coming to the best alternative, that is therefore the organization goals and objectives to be achieved. Then we will be implementing and monitoring whether any specific changes are to be made for the alternative or any necessary arrangements, adjustments to be there. Span of management. It is nothing but the number of subordinates who can be, you know, managed effectively by the superior. There is wide span of management or there is narrow span of management. Flat structure consists of the wide span of control of management. Tall structure consists of the narrow span of management. Thank you, everyone.